All right, so the next talk will be by Marius Kloft. And Marius has done a lot of very good work on kernel learning, PNOM regularization, and today he'll be talking about generalization bounds for error bounds for extreme multi-class classification.
Okay, so first of all, I wanted to say I'm chairing this event since 9 a.m. this morning. And I'm 9 hours jet lagged, and now I have the privilege to give the last talk. So it will be actually my great pleasure, but I need your help. Do you want my talk? Yeah. Okay, cool. Okay, great. So the talk will actually be about generalization error bounds for multi-class classification. And it's based on a recent archive preprint of my colleagues and me, and these colleagues are shown here. So, for example, this picture has been taken yesterday. So, my talk concerns actually multi-class classification, not multi-label classification, although the results could be generalized to multi-label classification. So in the setting considered here, really, we want to predict just one class for each data point. Yeah? Okay, so clearly there are several multi-class classification algorithms out there, and some algorithms that the results that I will present cover is multinomial logistic regression and also several so-called all-in-one multi-class SVMs, like, for example, Kram and Singer. Okay, so this talk is really about theory. If you want to hear more about algorithms, then I suggest you come to the WWW talk. Okay, so the scientific question that I want to address in this talk is actually, what is the scaling of generalization bounds for MCC in the number of classes? Because this is really interesting in XC, the scaling in the number of classes. And ideally, there would not be any scaling like that. Actually, we would have a constant scaling in the number of classes. That would be kind of ideal. And in my talk, I will show you that historically, many people or many bounds were actually showing a linear scaling. And then I will show you how in the past people have decreased that to square root. And actually, in this talk, I'm going to show you actually a log bound. Okay, so this is then the outline of the talk. I'm first going to show you the problem setting, then a little bit of historical overview, some new results, and then applications. Okay, so let's start with the problem setting, multi-class classification. We have some images, like my baby boy likes these images here, and they are annotated with some classes. And formally, I'm going to call these pairs Zi, and they consist of Xi and Yi. And the Yi is taken from one out of C many classes. So small c is actually the number of classes in the talk. Okay, it will occur very often. Okay, so the aim in multi-class classification from a theory point of view is to define a nice set of hypotheses such that, for example, this could be, as an example, linear hypothesis as shown here, potentially in some kernel Hilbert space, and the aim is to predict via the argmax rule. So, for example, if I give you say a data point lying here, say here, for example, then the argmax rule, in a nutshell, it would actually classify that instance to the closest class, in the sense that it would match the most with this vector here. Yeah, so this is the geometry behind the argmax rule. Okay, so thus we want actually the H component, corresponding to our actual training label, which is this guy here, to be larger than all other HY. Yeah? And this is measured usually through a loss function, and the interpretation is if this is not the case, then we will put a loss. Yeah? So generally, a multi-class classification loss function is thus not a loss function from the real into the reals, but from R to the power of C into the reals. Yeah? Okay. And we want, in theory, we want to have as small expected error of the loss as possible. No? Okay, so generally, we have two classes of generalization bounds, data-independent and data-dependent ones. In this talk, I'm going to focus on data-dependent bounds. Many of these data-dependent bounds are based on the Rademacher complexity. The interpretation of the Rademacher complexity is that it measures the size of my class of functions in the sense how well can they correlate with noise. Like the larger the class, the more it can match any random noise. So for example, say you are n times throwing the coin, and if head comes up, you put a plus one, and then tail comes up, you put minus one, and so on and so on. Then essentially what the Rademacher complexity does, it finds a function h that very well actually matches the labels. Yeah. So this measures the size of the set, essentially. Okay. So the nice thing is that if we know the Rademacher complexity, we are good to go. Because it's well known that besides some confidence terms, the generalization error is bounded by the Rademacher complexity. So here, you know, here we have the Rademacher complexity, and then here this term to the left is actually the generalization error. It is the expected error minus the training error. Expected error is the theoretical quantity that we would ideally to have small. Okay. So let's look at an example. A popular multiclass SVM is the one by Kramer and Singer. It involves a L2 norm constraint on the hyperplane normal vectors. And it employs actually a maximum over the hypothesis. As I, you know, explained on one of the previous slides here, you know, this argmax stuff, which corresponds to, yeah, classifying the points to the closest class, so to say. So this is what the Kramer and Singer SVM is based on. And thus, the Rademacher complexity involves this nasty maximum operator. And actually, the classical result was a maximum of some positive numbers is smaller than the sum of the positive numbers. Yeah? So therefore, by this argument, it's straightforward to translate the Rademacher complexity into a sum over Rademacher complexities, one for each class. But a sum over C many terms, it's a linear factor. It's like linear dependence on C. So that's the problem. Anyway, so this is the classical result. Okay. Now, in my talk at XC15, I showed you a way to actually produce a square root dependency on the number of classes. And at last year's workshop, it was shown how that could be generalized for to also other loss functions other than Kramer and Singer. And the key property is a Lipschitz property. Meyer showed this property also on his slides. It's shown here. So the key here is that one relates the nasty supremum over a vector-valued hypothesis class actually to a double sum that runs over the classes and over the number of training examples. Okay, so here is why this is so great. The improvement comes here from this picture, essentially. Look, if in the old analysis, one would have actually two suprema, one for W1, one for W2. In the new result, the supremum goes over W1 and 2 jointly. Yeah? And what happens here is the following. You can see it here from this image. If you take the suprema separately, like here, let's take this color, then you will end up here. And if you take this separately, you will end up here, right? But if you have the coupling, that's not possible. You can only you will end up here, so you can just run until here and here. So this is the advantage of this method of preserving actually that constraint. And if one looks into what is actually the difference between an L2 and an L-finity ball in a C-dimensional space, it's actually a factor of square root C. And this explains why the improvement from linear to square root C happens. Okay, so this was at the last 2 years. And today I'm going to talk about how a new result that achieves actually a logarithmic dependency on a number of classes. Okay, so let's look into this. So the key observation is, if we go back to this result here, then this involves actually Lipschitz property with respect to the L2 norm. Now, the problem is that typical loss functions that we use in multi-class classification involve a Lipschitz property with respect to the L-infinity norm with a much better constant than with respect to the L2 norm. So the common way how this in the past has been addressed is that you can bound the L2 norm in terms of the L-infinity norm. But the problem is that then a square root C factor actually comes into play. Now, the question that we asked when we started the work is, can we directly actually work with the L-infinity Lipschitz property? And here's that's exactly what we do, and here's some background on the methods that we use. So our new proof is actually based on covering numbers. So covering numbers are actually the following. Say you have data, you have your data points, right? You have n many data points like this, yeah. And now say I apply a function from my a prediction function from my hypothesis set to all these data points and write them into one vector. Then I have a vector in a vector space of dimension n, the sample size. Yeah? And if I do that for every function, I will get many, many, many points. So a cover of my function set is actually a set of balls in that n-dimensional space that that covers all those vectors that can be generated like this. Yeah. So for every such vector, I must find actually a ball that has it in its vicinity. And the thing is, we use covering numbers, but actually, usually people use them with respect to the L2 norm, but we use L infinity to match actually the loss function. So it's squares instead of balls. Yeah. Okay. So here's the core idea of our proof. It is, we consider a function class a function class H tilde, which is scalar valued. You know, the original class was vector value that has C many components. So now we consider a vector valued class, and it has for every index of data point and a component of the classes, it has one entry. So it so we consider a sample set that has C times n many entries, and each of these samples has actually a lot of zeros, but just at the j's position, if j is the class, we have phi of x. Yeah, so it has this sparsity structure. And now, because of this sparsity structure, we have the key property that actually, when we multiply with our w vector, then because of all those zeros, it extracts exactly the wj. So this is very nice. Because when we traverse now all I and j, we have actually extracted all of those scalar products here. Yeah. And by this method, we show actually the following bound. We show that the L infinity covering numbers of the class that we really want to bound, it's this one, is upper bounded by the covering number of the newly defined class. And the way we prove this is we consider a cover with respect to this easier class, so to say, and show that it induces also a cover of the class that we really care about. So this is the idea of the proof. So the nice thing is that this class here is easily tackled, like it's known from the literature. So we arrive at actually at the following main theorem, and that is that the Rademacher complexity can be upper bounded by square root C times a Rademacher complexity of this new class H tilde that depends on n times C many samples. And so the logic of the proof is like this. The Rademacher complexity can be bounded by the Rademacher complexity of the difficult class, so to say, can be bounded by its covering number. Then we can apply the result and relate that to the covering numbers of this new scalar valued class. And then actually this is the first step is by Dudley's integral, and then the last step by Sauer-Schellard lemma, which are usual techniques for that. Okay, so and then we need to bound also the Rademacher complexity, but that we know very well. And for example, when we use an L2 norm constraint on the hypothesis class, then we get actually a 1 over square root C dependence on the number of classes. And now the interesting thing is we have here 1 over square root C and 1 over square root C. It really matches and cancels out. Yeah. There's actually also some log C term left. It probably could be removed, but right now we have some log C term left in the analysis. Okay, so the bottom line is for the new result, we have bound depending logarithmically in the number of classes. And now I'm going to show you some applications. Applications in learning theory usually mean more bounds. Specifically, we'll look into two algorithms, multi-class SVM by Kramer and Singer and multinomial logistic regression. And for those methods, the comparison is like this. We have, for the classic bound, we had a factor of C that, you know, bounds the Rademacher complexity as a sum of Rademacher complexities. For the result from the last 2 years workshop, there's a square root C dependence. Now with the new bound, we have a log C dependence. So one interesting thing is here, however, as you can see here, that for the first two bounds, we have actually here the average norm of the data appearing, while in our new bound, there's actually the maximum norm. If you have, for example, RBF kernels, that's the same actually, but if not, then it will be different terms. No? So generally, the result by three will have then maybe a little larger constant. Okay, so here's some more comparisons by the former result. You can see here you get all kinds of, yeah, mostly square root dependencies, except for Weston and Watkins, which is worse, c to the power of 3/2. And for the new result, one obtains logarithmic dependency on the number of classes. There's also some method that I presented 2 years ago, the workshop, which is LP-norm, MCSVM, that has a little different rate, and that depends strongly on the p. Actually, if you choose p equals 1, then already the old result can achieve a log c bound. But this is a very specific algorithm. Yeah, and like I said, one thing that one keep in mind is that the constants might be different. No? Okay, so in conclusion, I'd like to say that we derived a data-dependent bound with multi-dependency on a number of classes, logarithmic for Kramer-Singer, multinomial, logistic regression, and many other MCSVMs. The key was here to exploit the L-infinity Lipschitz property of the loss function. And directions are extensions to multi-label. That might actually not be too difficult. And also interesting would be a bound independent of the class size. Maria indicated already that such a bound would be possible and will be interesting to look into this proof. Okay, so thank you for your attention.
We have time for questions.
Yeah.
So what the actual multiplier should be? Do you believe that you can get rid of the lock?
We're still looking into it, whether we can get rid of it in our analysis. Sometimes these log factors, they occur, and they are sometimes also worrisome, like they only occur because of the proof technique. So Maria indicated that with his proof technique that he doesn't have the log c factor, but there's still some step in his proof that I don't quite see how he's improving that, using that result, so I'm first waiting for the proof to be printed.
Okay, so you propose a new algorithm, or is it the same algorithm with improved leaf generalization bound? So my question is, you provide a new classifier or existing classifier with improved analysis here.
Yeah, actually, no, we don't we don't present a new classifier. So yeah, in our previous analysis 2 years ago, actually we had some algorithm motivated by the bounds, but this time we didn't do it. Yeah, so this is a good question. So that might be actually a next step. Okay, thank you for your attention.
Let's thank Marius once again for his tireless service throughout the day.